I thank you all for the sweet presence you have given me this evening. I thank our hostess who is very hospitable and very kind enough to create this occasion also once again. Since I came many times here, I find quite homely with the atmosphere and with the place. The subject of the evening's lecture is the evolution of consciousness. It is really a vast subject which includes many divisions and subdivisions, and it is a subject which has been dealt with in all the ancient scriptures of the ancient nations. And every scripture, it seems, has the same way of explaining the evolution of consciousness. Unlike the modern psychological science, there is another dimension to this subject in the ancient scriptures. That is the consciousness of the individual and the consciousness of the background. With due respects to modern psychology, it deals with only the consciousness of the individual, and it doesn't take into cognizance till now the consciousness of the background. Till now, it is not believed by the modern scientific people that space has a mind and a consciousness. Space is the immediate background of our existence. We live in space along with our planet Earth and our body and all the planes of consciousness that exist in our body. In the Earth, there are as many planes of consciousness as there are in our body. And all these planes interpenetrate each other. And what we normally call consciousness, according to our understanding, is only a resultant of all these thousands of consciousnesses at work. It can be compared with the surface tension of liquids. For example, the individual consciousness, which we know as ourselves, is not an item in itself, but it is a resultant of all the planes of consciousness meeting in us. That's the reason why our consciousness is changing every time. The degree of illumination of our consciousness changes from state to state. And when we say we are awake, and when we say we are asleep, when we say we are dreaming, all these are various planes of consciousness, and our consciousness changes from plane to plane. What we call psychology depends upon only these three planes: the awakened plane, the sleep plane, and the dream plane. Since these three planes of consciousness are only floating upon the thousands of planes of consciousness working on this earth, our study of psychology will not be complete until we understand the background of consciousness. Because psychology is bound to be individual in its nature. Any attempt to make a generalization is only an approximation in psychology. So, the subject is approached from a different direction in the ancient scriptures and the spiritual books. In the 20th century, all the wisdom has been brought to light by the masters of wisdom through one author, Madam Helena Petrova Blavatsky. And when she gave out the analysis of the planes of consciousness, when she dealt with the consciousness of the individual and the planetary consciousness of this earth, and when she stated that the planetary consciousness of this earth works as the background consciousness of the individuals on this earth, and the solar consciousness of our total solar system works as the background of our earth's planetary consciousness, and the still bigger background consciousness to the millions of solar systems at work, which put together make up the one unit space globe. It is called the globe consciousness or the cosmic consciousness. So, for our purpose, it is better to remember that the cosmic consciousness is working as the eternal background of each unit of space globe, and on the background of that consciousness, the millions of solar systems are coming into existence. Each solar system is undergoing its own evolution, sending forth the planetary bodies to revolve around itself. And on the background of this solar consciousness, each planet works out its own evolution. And on the background of each planetary consciousness, the atoms of that planet work out the evolution of the living beings of the planet. Same is the case with our earth also. The earth consciousness, which we can call the planetary consciousness of this earth, is the background on which all the atoms of our earth globe work. And these atoms undergo many stages of evolution until they undergo a series of awakenings, and finally they come to what we call the nuclear evolution, that is the formation of the atoms. And the formation of the atoms on the etheric plane takes place, and it results in the formation of the atoms on the physical plane, and each atom works out its own evolution and it enters into the nuclear awakening. It will have its own nucleus and the body is revolving around itself
de lui.
To keep up the stage of that particular atom. The whole activity corresponds with that of the solar system, with the sun as the center and the planets revolving around the sun. When these atoms on the earth plane awaken, they awaken into the nuclear consciousness, they begin to work out the various states of matter on this earth. That is the gases, the liquids and the solids. And then there is the next awakening, which is called the mineral awakening, by which the atoms enter into the mineral kingdom of this earth and have many awakenings into the many types of minerals, each keeping its properties, which we call the chemical and the physical properties. And these properties are conducted and maintained by the intelligences that are working in nature. And these intelligences are called the Deva kingdom in the ancient Indian scripture. It is due to the work of these intelligences that every substance keeps up its own properties of matter, its own atomic weight and its own periodicity table, its own atomic number and its own molecular properties. That is what we call the identity of the substance. The identity of the substance is nothing but the intelligences working consistently in the atoms. For example, you observe that salt is always salty in its taste and sugar is always sweet in its taste. And it requires an inner consciousness for salt to keep up salt nature and sugar to keep up sugar nature, and the liquid state to keep up the properties of liquids, the gaseous state to keep up the properties of the gases, and the solid state to keep up the properties of solid. When we observe that these properties are consistent in their behavior, we have to further understand that they are presided over and governed by intelligences that are working behind them. These intelligences are units of consciousness who are self-conscious, who are self-awakened, and who work according their own plan. These are called self-illumined. In Sanskrit, they are called devas. The word deva means illumined. They are self-illumined or self-intelligenced. And these intelligences work out and keep up the consistency of the properties of matter until the minerals pass through the various stages of evolution. That is, the metals and the non-metals, the acidic and the alkaloid, and the various chemical and the isotopic stages. And after passing through their various stages of evolution, they get the next awakening into the next consciousness. That is what is called the biological consciousness. So, after the nuclear awakening, they have the biological awakening. That is, they enter into a new dimension of consciousness, which we call feeling. Of course, sensation and feeling are there. They are almost near. And the first awakening into the biological kingdom is the plant life. For example, the chlorine group of intelligences of deva consciousness, they begin to work out and they invite the energy of the solar ray to synthesize the consciousness, to make manifest the biological consciousness. And the difference between a mineral and a plant is then discovered. The plant feels the presence and absence of sunshine and water and the various materials around. Of course, the minerals also behave towards sunshine. They also have their behavior towards water. For example, the rusting of iron and the heliotropism of various minerals. But their consciousness includes only behavior and no sensation. Behavior.
Le comportement.
And no sense. So from a consciousness of behavior to a consciousness of sensation, there will be next awakening called the plant awakening. After undergoing the various stages in the plant awakening, the atom begins to become a living being, gathering millions of atoms around itself to form its own body. The living atom differentiates itself to live different from the atoms that make up its own body. The living atom is called the living being, whereas the other atoms are called the constituents of the body of the living being. And then after completing the plant kingdom, it enters into the next awakening, which is called the animal kingdom. The difference between the plant and the animal kingdom is, in the plants there is only the sensation and the feeling, but in the animal kingdom the feeling is localized, the sensation is also localized, and the mechanism to feel and to sense is separated from the other parts of the body. We find the formation of the brain cells and the vertebral column and the production of the nervous system, which is different from the vascular system of the plant kingdom. Animals and plants have vascular system in common. The tubes of xylem and phloem in plants, xylem, phloem, that is the tubes which cause the passage of water from roots to the tree, and the tubes which convey the material of food from the leaves to the tree, they are there in the animal kingdom also, in a more evolved and advanced stage, which we call the blood vessels or the vascular system, the veins and the arteries. And separate from these, apart from these two systems, we have the nervous system also formed in the animal kingdom. The function of the nervous system is to conduct and convey the consciousness through channels. Since there is no such arrangement in the plant kingdom, self-consciousness exists only in the form of feeling and sensation. For example, if we make an injury on a plant, the whole plant feels pain and it cannot feel the localization of pain because the nervous system is not formed. In the animal kingdom, the nervous system is formed and developed gradually, and the brain cells are separated from the other parts of the body. The brain cells are arranged to work as the center of the mind. Of course, mind is different from the brain cells, just as the chair you sit is different from yourself. The brain cells are like the chair, and the mind is like the person who is working in the chair. And the separation of the brain cells and the formation of the nervous system causes a localization of feelings and sensations. And as the mechanism advances, the system of responses to stimulus becomes more and more advanced. In plants also, we find the response. For example, a plant bends towards the incidence of the sun rays, and water plants bend towards water, and there are some plants which contract when we touch. There are plants which kill animals. Like this, there are responses in the plant kingdom also, but they are not mind propelled. They are only instinctive and not motive. That is, there is no particular place where from the idea is sent, but they respond to the environment. In the animal kingdom, we find all the mechanism gradually developing, and the more advancement in it, the more advancement is necessitated the evolution of the vertebral column. Just as a village developing into a town requires a more advanced communication system and requires a bigger municipal office with more departments in it, and just as the town developing into a city requires a corporation to work and quicker communications like the telephone and television, similarly, the advancement of the unfolding consciousness necessitated the need of the vertebral column, and there is the vertebrata among the animals. And animals with the vertebral column began to understand their environment. And we know animals who know their house where to they return in the evening. And in the villages in the tropical countries like India, you find when the cattle is left into the forest or the mountain, and in the evening they return to their own houses. We know how our dogs recollect and recognize their masters, how the cats recognize their masters, and how they return to their houses exactly. And this is a marked stage in the evolution of consciousness. If we observe the birds that have come from the animal kingdom in its early stages of evolution, we find the evolution of consciousness quicker among the birds. Almost all the planes of consciousness that are working in the human kingdom are working in the birds also. And certain planes of consciousness that are not working in the average human being are also working among some birds. You will find that some birds behave in the same manner as the other birds of the community behave. There are birds who do not marry away from their community. And there are birds who build their nest always in the same way. It was for some time understood by the biology professors that it was a habit copied from the parents. But when they have conducted some experiments, proved that it was not the habit. For example, a couple of birds are brought and maintained without building the nest. And for 7 generations, they were not allowed to build the nest. And when the 8th generation was left out free, they went to their trees and they built their nests exactly in the same manner, identical to the shape of the nests built by the forefather. So the biologists came to suspect that there is another layer of mind which exists away from what we call the psychological consciousness. Our science of psychology does not work on this plane. It is also observed that there are certain birds existing in the Arctic regions, in the polar regions, where birds live in the holes of snow. They travel in groups all through the world, and according to the seasons they travel, they cross the equator and they reach the South Pole, lay their eggs and die. The children coming out of these eggs, they begin their journey northwards, and according to the seasons they travel all the parts of the globe. And finally they reach the North Pole. And exactly each bird enters the hole of its parent, sure, left. So it reaches its own hereditary property without a mistake. And there it lays its eggs. True. And it dies. And these children coming out of the eggs, they travel again southwards. They reach the South Pole and enter into the same hole which was left by their parent. Just as a person who purchases a flat in Belgium, after leaving India, for some reason dies in Belgium, then his son starts for India, goes and enters exactly his father's house. Like that, we see these birds observed by scientists and regarded having a consciousness which we are not having. This is because consciousness exists in different layers. And it is only the awakening of that particular living being into that consciousness that makes it work. What we all call consciousness is like the electric light in our room. When we on this switch, the room is illumined. But the room was already there even in darkness. Similarly, what we call consciousness is nothing but the degree of illumination or awakening. And among some animals also, we find some dimensions of consciousness which we do not find in average human beings. For example, some dogs, some species of dogs and some birds can sense the death of a living being at least 6 hours before. In villages, in some countries, dogs begin to bark in crowds when a person is going to die within 24 hours. From the type of the barking of the dog, the people understand that somebody is going to die in that street. Though there is much superstition about this, there is some truth around which superstition is woven. And we know how dogs can hear sounds which we do not. When the silent whistles are given, which cannot be heard by the human ear, the dogs can hear and gather. So, we can understand consciousness in terms of layers and layers. And evolution is only an awakening of each layer of consciousness. We find all the animals and birds having their own level of consciousness working separately. And finally, when the evolution of the animal consciousness is completed, then the animal enters into the human kingdom. And then we call it the human consciousness. It is the next awakening which we can call the human awakening. The main difference between the animal consciousness and the human consciousness is that the animal can know everything, its house, its master, its environment, its enemies, its friends, its relatives, but it does not feel its own existence. When it comes to the human level, the human being begins to feel that he is existing. The animal has also got pain, but the pain is only subjective and it never feels its existence even when it feels pain. The human being begins to feel the existence of himself, and hence he has the anticipation of pain, whereas the animal cannot have an anticipation of pain without any conditioning.